Okay. Good evening, everybody. Can you hear me? Is this working? Sounds like it's working. I probably don't need it. Anyway, thank you so much for coming. We're so excited that you're here, each and every one of you. This is a glorious opportunity for Woodstock, and one which I'm really happy to be here to generate enthusiasm for from the experience that I had in 2006, participating in the last time we did this. And I can see a lot of people here who were involved in that, and a lot of great things have come out of it. And this is a wonderful opportunity for all these new young people, and I know so many of you who have moved here since then, to have your voice. And you're going to have a lot of fun at this project. It's really terrific, and the amount of community spirit that comes out of this is really wonderful. So, if I didn't say, my name is Liza Degnan, and I've been living here since the mid-80s, and I've had the pleasure of working in Woodstock all that time, doing a number of different things. And I'm looking at my friend Jeff over here, who also manages to both live and work in Woodstock, and that's a grand opportunity that's not available to a lot of people. So it's been a great 30-something years for me, and I'm so pleased that you're all here to carry on. Isn't it wonderful to be in charge of our own destiny here, and to have all these people who care and who are talented and who are passionate and who have the time that they're willing to give to this? I'm so personally grateful. So I want to introduce my friend Teo, who is on the steering committee here for this fabulous event, and also is the executive director at the Adequici Health Foundation, where I had the good privilege of being the board chair for a length of time. And she also comes from artistry, where she really set them off on that grand path they're on, and we do love that. So, my friend, Teo Kirshner.
Thank you, Liza. And thank everybody for being here tonight, too, because this is really setting the stage for the whole project. And kind of in contrast to what Liza said, you know, I wasn't part of the VCRD planning 15 years ago, and I don't live in Woodstock. But I have a unique perspective of what makes Woodstock what it is. I started my relationship with this town when I was young. I used to volunteer at Vins when it was up on the hill. And then I actually worked at the one-hour photo shop in town between my between my college summers when it was here, right on Main Street. And I remember, you know, the mile-high apple pies. And I have stuffed animals that I've passed on to my daughter that I purchased in the retail shops downtown. So I kind of circled back around to this location in my professional life when I started artistry in 2009. And now I'm at the Adequici Health Foundation. You know, that was over 10 years ago. So a majority of my working life has been in this town that I feel pretty passionate about. I spend more time here than I do in my own hometown of Randolph. And I want to just mention this because the past, my past, your past, the present and the future really set the stage for what this community planning process is all about. Our stories, our successes, our failures are all an important part of how this all kind of comes together. I recently went through the VCRD process in Randolph, which is my hometown. And that was pretty amazing to watch that community, who is not nearly as involved as Woodstock is, But everybody kind of came out of the woodwork for that, and it's still going on. And we've filled vacant storefronts in town, and we've created events that have really brought that vibrancy back to that downtown. So these type of processes are just really, really important. Woodstock and this area has that passion, has the experience, and has the community drive to invest in this. And that's what's really important, I think, to remember while we're all talking about this tonight. We have the potential to create communities that we want to live and work in, and a future that we all really want to support. And that's something that I feel is of utmost importance for us to remember tonight. And so one of the more important aspects of this project and some of the drivers behind it is the team at the community workshop. And they've really come out with some creative ways to address and get us all interacting with each other. So I want to pass over to Rebecca Stone, who is the founder and principal at Community Workshops. So thank you.
Much. It's an honor to be here, everyone. I can't actually take credit for being a founder. I have a wonderful partner, David Hohenschau, who really started Community Workshop, and the two of us have been so excited to work together and grow this business and grow really a whole field and a new way of doing planning since our years long ago of working together at the Orton Family Foundation. Some of you may know of that process, and if you do, you'll see elements of it throughout our work with you here in Woodstock. We hold really deep beliefs about doing things differently. You all in Woodstock have been fortunate to participate in a lot of planning processes before, including some VCRD summits, including some really recent ones that you'll hear a little bit more about tonight. How many of you have been to some planning meetings before, community meetings? Yeah, a lot of people. How many of you actually read the full plan cover to cover when it was done? Be honest. Wow, a few hands. That wouldn't happen in a lot of communities, so more engaged here in Woodstock than most places. How many of you know and are up to speed on what was supposed to happen from those processes and feel like it really happened? Yeah. And here I think is the most important question. How many of you really had fun? Okay, one, two, Allison in the back. So I'm asking you those questions in part because I think that's gonna validate us being here. I hope it will, at least. There are a lot of planning processes. Communities go through them all the time. When we come into a community, usually it's because that community is ready to do things a little bit differently. We are not quite the typical planning firm and organization. When we come in, it often is to try to make planning a little bit more fun than it's been in the past, to try to make sure that things happen on the outside. Here's another question for you. Take a minute and look around the room. How many of you feel like the people you see around you are a pretty good representation of who's in Woodstock? Any hands going up? Yeah, that's what I thought. Now, this is not a dig at Woodstock at all. Again, we're so excited that all of you are here tonight, and you're here because you are engaged and you care and you know the value of this process. When we leave tonight, we're going to give you a few charges. And our charge throughout this process is to make sure that if we come and ask the question 3 months from now, did this process engage the full range of people in Woodstock? The answer is yes. It doesn't need to be everyone here in this room tonight, but that is a reason why we come in and work with communities, to help make sure it's a whole community conversation. So all that said, we're really excited to be here. We have a packed evening for you tonight. We're going to do a little bit of an introduction to why we're even in this room, what this process is about, what's going to be ahead in the next few months. And because there's so much going on in Woodstock already, we are also going to give you a chance to hear from some leaders of community projects and get some updates on what's going on there as well. And as I said, we'll give you some homework, or maybe I should say a challenge. When we leave tonight, I hope all of you will leave with some new ideas and some inspiration and interest in participating and help spreading the word. So we'll encourage you to do that. As we get started, I want to ask one logistical question, and that is, does everyone have in their hands a little plastic keypad?
No.
Okay. If you do not, raise your hand. I'm going to ask Claire and Kate to help pass those out a little bit. While they do that, I'm going to give you another challenge just while we are taking a minute to get organized here. So in every event we do, we try to actually move forward a little bit as a community as well, try to move forward towards towards some of the goals that we know that are out there. And as soon as we started talking to the steering committee and leaders in Woodstock, some of the things we heard is that people need to know each other a little bit more. They need to listen to each other. We need to know each other's experience. So while we're hitting the last folks who need keypads, here's your challenge.
We're out.
We're out. Okay, I take it back. If you don't have one, we're going to ask you to buddy up with someone next to you. So if you're sitting next to two people who don't have them, then we'll shuffle a couple around,
put
okay?
Put your hands up again.
Put your hands up if you're not next to someone who has one.
You want to
everyone
show
has that?
Okay. Who needs one?
Great.
I've got three in here.
One in the back?
Yeah.
Great. Perfect.
Pass that along.
Okay. So while we're getting settled, here's your challenge. Take a minute, and I want you all to just introduce yourselves to each other. Chances are some of you are sitting next to folks you know very, very well. So if you see someone on a side of you who you don't know very well, please pick that person instead. Introduce yourself with name, where you're from, why you're here. And that's just what we want you to do. And in fact, when we wrap up in here, we'll have another half hour out there that you can go back and have conversations with everyone you just met and meet some folks you didn't still. Before we really dive in tonight, though, I just want to also do really quick introductions to the crew behind this. So I mentioned I'm from Community Workshop. I actually live just up at the road in Bethel and have been there for about 11 years. So very familiar with Woodstock, and it's really fun to be doing a project right in our backyard. At Community Workshop, we actually do projects all across North America, working with communities and municipalities and nonprofits. So really fun to be here in Woodstock. I'm going to ask the other two members of our team here to introduce themselves tonight, and then want to introduce the Woodstock team as well. Claire, do you want to jump up?
Sure. Claire Tapps with Community Workshop. Nice to be here. Thanks for coming out tonight.
And I'm Kate Bernan, also with Community Workshops. You'll see me running around.
Fabulous. And we have a fantastic steering committee that has come together to really figure out what this project should be and how to get it organized and how to create an amazing buffet spread for you and this seamless evening here tonight. So I want to ask all the steering committee members as well to stand up, and we'll just quickly go around and do some introductions names. So can we just start with you, Alita, and we'll go around?
Alita Wilson.
Teo Kirchhoff.
Geraldine Fowler.
Deanna Jones.
Susan Boston.
Beth Finlayson.
Kimberly Gilbert.
Sally Miller.
Anna Dina Talley.
Fabulous. And then we have another whole group of people who were involved even before that, who started having conversations last year about should Woodstock embark on another community planning process and a visioning process, and really putting in some time and effort to write an RFP and come up with funding and identify what that should be. So I want to ask those folks to please stand up in the room as well. Do We have any folks who are involved in that steering committee can stand up. We have a few others, though, I think. Nobody? Folks who were involved in shaping this process from the get-go. You're one of them, Allison. I think you're one of the cheerleaders. Yeah. So thank you to everyone. A little confusion. All right. With that, I really want to dive in tonight. So here's your chance to play with the keypads that I just handed out. If you've ever had dreams of sitting in the audience at American Idol, this is your chance tonight. Quick introduction to those keypads. You'll notice that it has a number of buttons on it. So there are letters and numbers. We're going to give you choices with letters on them tonight. You'll see a bunch of choices up on the screen when I press start. So you need to look at your answer choice and then look at your keypad and vote for the choice that best fits. If there are only five choices up on the screen and you vote number seven, that's kind of like a write-in. It's not going to do you any good. So you're welcome to do it, but I wouldn't suggest wasting your vote. You'll also see a few other buttons like go. I wouldn't suggest pushing them. You never know what's going to happen with those. We'll go through a series of questions throughout tonight really to get a sense of who's in the room and what your priorities are for this process. So here's the most important thing you need to know. You don't vote until I tell you that polling is open, because again, it will not register your vote. Once I say polling is open, then you can push your button and your light will turn green and it will count, and then I'll give you about a 5-second warning when we're ready to close it, and you will see the results instantly up on the screen, if all goes well. Those of you who do not have your own,
Rebecca,
yes.
If we're sharing a pad, how do we both get the
That's what I was just about to say. Okay. So if you're sharing a keypad, just hand it to the person next to you after you're finished, and that vote will register too. Now, some of you folks may be really smart in the audience sitting there thinking, oh, I could just do a second vote. So you could, but let's all be honest and fair. There's no need to rack up the vote tallies tonight. This is all about getting a sense of who's in the room, okay? No skewing the ballot box. So I always like to give folks a couple easy ones to warm up here. We're gonna start with an easy one tonight. You know you're from Woodstock when dress out means cocktail dress and muck boots. I think after this week's rain, we might have a few folks in here tonight. You're sick of saying, no, not that Woodstock. Or you don't even try to park downtown in the fall. All right? So think about your choice. You're going to push A, B, or C. And polling is open. Okay? So I can see how many are coming in. We've got about 45 votes. We'll give it another 10 seconds. If you haven't voted or you're handing it next door, go right ahead. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Hey, we have a winner. All right, let's get a sense of who actually is here tonight. So where do you live? Are you from South Woodstock, West Woodstock, Taftville? Do you live in the village? Do you live elsewhere within the town? Or are you from somewhere beyond Woodstock? Polling is open. Whoops, let's try again. Let's try again. Here we go. Okay, try again. Now it's working. Okay, we got about 60 folks. We'll give it 10 more seconds.
If it's blinking yellow instead of turning green and then it turns red, is there a problem?
There is a problem. If you're not getting a green light, you may have one with a battery issue, so why don't you use someone's next door to you and borrow. 5 more seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. Okay. So a lot of folks in the village, West Woodstock. Really great number of people from beyond town. And this is very exciting to us because, as Teo so eloquently said, this is not a conversation just for Woodstock residents. This is about everyone who spends time in Woodstock, learns in Woodstock, plays in Woodstock, loves Woodstock. So we're really glad, especially to have those of you from beyond town. All right, how long have you lived in this area? So we'll use area loosely. If you lived in Pomfret and you moved to Woodstock, that counts, all right? How long you've been in this general area. Polling is open. Okay. 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. Fabulous. I'm hearing a lot of wows. What's surprising? So many more than 20 years. I will tell you, this doesn't surprise me a bit. And when I asked you earlier if this audience reflects who you think is in Woodstock, this is the telling question. So the folks who live in town for a long time tend to come out, they're invested, they know what's going on. One of our biggest challenges making this a whole community conversation is gonna be to reach the people who've just moved here or haven't been here very long. And that's where we're gonna need all of your help.
Rebecca, will these slides be available to the public afterwards?
Yes, we'll put up all these results.
Great.
Absolutely. Great. So you can rest your keypad fingers for a few minutes. We'll come back to them before the evening's out. But I want to move forward a little bit. Now that we know a little bit about who's here in the room, we want to spend a little bit of time talking about what we're doing with this process, why we're here, and where we're going. And to do that, I want to actually reintroduce you to some things about Woodstock that you might not be familiar with. I'm guessing most of you in the room really are experts about your community. You know the streets, you know how to get around, you know where to find information, you know what the challenges are, you know what the opportunities are, and what the resources are. But we were brought here to help you think not about what Woodstock today is going to be, but what Woodstock 2030, 2050, 2070 is going to be. And not actually what that's predestined to be, but how we create it together. So there are two pieces of this. When we are talking about a vision and creating the future we want to see, there are the parts that you can just imagine and create. We asked you to start doing that out in the lobby already. What do you wish for Woodstock's future? What do you love and want to see here? But there's another piece as well, which is understanding what path we're already on, what trends are out there, what's happening in the world that's going to shape the choices we have and shape where we're going today. Some of these are pretty good guesses of what's going to happen, what Woodstock might look like in 2030. Some are absolutely wild guesses. Some are things that we really don't know at all. But I just want to give you a quick snapshot of the kinds of things we're up against, the uncertainty and the certainty that we need to factor into this conversation moving forward. So here are a few things to think about. One thing we know is that Woodstock in 2030 is going to be older than it is today. And most of the statistics I'm giving you right now are not unique. In fact, all of them are not unique to Woodstock at all. This is the story of Vermont. This is the story of our rural communities. And in some cases, the story of our American communities. Anyone know how much older Woodstock is going to be?
5 years.
So by 2030, good points, 29% of Vermonters will be over the age of 60. That's a 40% increase from where we are today. Just let that sink in for a minute. So 30% of the population will be over the age of 60. This raises really essential questions as we're moving forward. Our communities aren't designed for older adults to stay in place and to have the kind of vibrant lives that they want to have. So we have a lot of questions. Where will our older adults live? How can they stay in Woodstock if they want to stay here? How will they get around? Where will they shop and eat? Are they able to even step up into some of your beautiful storefronts on Main Street that may not have access for people with disabilities? This is, of course, foremost on my mind, having just had ACL surgery. So I strongly recommend anyone who wants to think about accessibility and how to navigate a community, put on a brace and use crutches for a week and see what it's like to try to navigate Woodstock. More important even than that, questions for our older adults is how will they stay active and socially connected? It turns out social capital and relationships are the single biggest predictors of longevity for older adults. Most older adults also don't want to just age in place, they want to contribute. They have so much value to offer and they bring tremendous assets to a community. So how do we create a community in 2030 that's ready to capitalize on our older adults and really make them feel welcome and able to keep contributing? At the same time, Woodstock will also be younger. So Generation X is about the smallest generation we have. We have some larger generations coming ahead. We're going to have more younger adults and more millennials coming in. One thing we know about these folks is that they don't want the same kind of community that we have today. They don't want the same kind of lifestyle. They don't want the same housing. They don't want the same transportation. They have different priorities. So if we look across the state of Vermont, we're expecting somewhere around 111,300 30 to 45 year olds around 2030. That's a lot of folks in that generation gap that will be coming up. That will be our workforce. Those will be the folks raising families. They'll be the folks buying houses or not buying houses. So we need to think not just about what Woodstock residents today are going to want for this community of 2030, but what this next generation is going to want. Yeah?
Do you have the population of Vermont increasing over the next 10 years?
I would have to go, I'm sorry, good question. Or decreasing. Yeah, there's not a really solid answer to that. I think there are a couple projections. These numbers are out of
625,000. Yeah.
Roughly. I think it could go a little bit up, it could go a little bit down. Most of the population increase is going to happen in places like Chittenden County. It's going to happen in Montpelier. There is a fairly good burst in the Upper Valley. And the reason for that is because of the values and because of what these younger generations want. They want almost urban style living. Not that it has to be an urban area. They're quite happy with our small towns, but they want the amenities that you could get in an urban area. They want to be able to walk out of work and walk down the street and meet friends for an evening meal. They don't want to have to own a car. They don't want to be saddled with a huge mortgage. They want to have the social connections that are somewhat missing today. So I am by no means suggesting that Woodstock should become Burlington or should become an urban agglomeration. But I'm suggesting that we think about what's great about urban areas, what this generation wants to have, and how we might be able to build that into the community today. And interestingly, those same benefits and things that this younger generation wants are often the same things that will make life wonderful for that senior citizen generation we're talking about. It's accessibility, it's transportation options, it's housing options, it's social connections. Big questions here for them as well, though. Where will they live exactly? How will they get around if they don't have cars? Where are they going to want to shop and eat? Will it be the same kinds of places? Where will they work, and where will they want to work? And really, what kind of town do these new generations want to live in? Stepping back a little bit as well, this can be controversial in some towns, but for the most part, when we bring this up, people understand that this is just a fact of life these days. Across America, we are expecting that 13 million people might be displaced due to climate change, only sea level rise, in fact. We're not even talking about other climate hazards by the end of the next century. 13 million people from coastlines. This is one scenario depicting what New Jersey might look like. So when we're asking what Vermont's population could look like, this is a huge X factor, in fact, and this is one of the reasons why population estimates are so uncertain. Because we don't know how many people across the country or across the world will be forced from their homes, and we don't know how many of them would want to come here. But this is a really serious conversation that folks are having at the state level in Vermont right now. How many climate refugees might we expect to have? And probably we can expect to have a bunch, because Vermont is one of the places that, believe it or not, will be less hard hit by climate change. If you look across Vermont, Woodstock is probably one of the places that will be most appealing to a lot of the folks who are forced out of their homes along the seacoast. So, how many folks will come here? Where will they live? Who will they be? What kinds of people will be moving into our community? How will we provide services if we get more people? And what benefits and opportunities will they bring for us? This is one that's extremely uncertain, but I can tell you this, if we're planning just for the numbers that we have today, or the numbers we might predict based on Vermont's past growth, we may be sorely surprised in 20 years to find out how many people are really moving to this area. Climate change in general is one to think about. So Vermont as a whole is predicted to have a 3.5 degree increase over 1895 temperatures by 2030. We've already experienced over a 2 degree increase, and we're seeing it right now. We're seeing it in increased precipitation and storms, increased flooding and erosion. We are seeing it in droughts. We're seeing it in invasive species. We're seeing it in changes in forest cover. We're seeing decreased snowmelt and loss on our mountains in the winter. Lots of questions here. We don't know how bad it will get. We don't know exactly what the impacts will be, but we have some ideas, and we need to be planning for this. How will we stay cool? How will we help our vulnerable and older adults stay cool in housing? How will our farms adapt and begin to grow food differently? Will our forests burn? This is a really interesting one. A big project we've done recently is helping the state have conversations about hazard mitigation planning and a lot of smart people from agencies and nonprofits sat in a room and said, okay, let's rank our top hazards as a state. Everybody can guess what's number one, I bet. Floods, right? Because that's what we have right now. That's what we've had in the past. And if you go back through 100 years of Vermont data, floods are what we have. But we had one particularly smart person stand up. This was actually during August last year when most of California was burning. Mm-hmm. And she said, wait a minute, we're planning for the past. With climate change, can our forests burn? Forest fires were way down on that list. Drought was way down on that list. But after that conversation, they have moved up. And Vermont's recognizing that even though these may not have been concerns in the past, even though they may not be today so much, they will be by 2030. We need to think about these. We have bigger questions. What is winter even going to look like? What will our winter economy look like? What will our economy in general look like under climate change? It may not all be bad. In fact, there may be opportunities here as well. One other interesting one I heard on the radio just last week is around automation and changes in our workforce and jobs. And this was absolutely fascinating to me. So an estimated 73 million jobs may be gone in America due to automation and robotics. So think about all the areas where robots are replacing factories, workers, things like that. And then think about a whole another set that you haven't even thought about before. So we know that autonomous vehicles are coming on the road. These studies by McKinsey and Company estimated that truck drivers will be basically obsolete by 2030. Taxi drivers may be obsolete. Accountants may be obsolete. Anyone know other jobs?
Attorneys,
that was one that came up. Sports referees. I find that fascinating. Maybe not here in small town Vermont. I can't quite imagine a robot taking the place of the ref at my daughter's soccer games, but it could be. Does anyone have a sense of what jobs will not be obsolete?
Senior center directors.
You bet. You bet.
Nursing.
Nursing, some nursing will be replaced, but the part that's really hands-on and working with patients will not. What did you say?
Plumbers, electricians, builders.
Yeah. Some trades, hands-on. There's one big, big sector that I haven't heard yet. Service, some will, some won't. Travel agents will be gone, but the folks waiting here. Teachers, hopefully, you know, we'll see changes in teaching for sure. We're going to see more online classes, more automation. Right. So there's the flip side of it, right? What jobs will change? Which ones are going to be gone, but which ones are we going to gain? What different jobs will we have in Woodstock that we never even thought about before? How might our lives improve under this scenario? How might they not? What aspects of our lives might we miss once this automation takes place? What does this mean for town services? What does Woodstock need to think about providing or not providing? What will the shape of the economy be? And what should students learn? How should we prepare our students for a world in which some of the jobs they learn today won't even be there anymore? So I still didn't hear the main sector where folks see a lot of promise under this scenario. Any ideas? That's a great suggestion. Interestingly, I think some of them may go by the wayside as well. Robots are getting pretty good at conversation. Yeah. Yeah, those are all open questions. Nobody knows the answer to this. I don't think anyone's expecting tourism to decline because of this. It might decline because our snow goes away. But the jobs that serve that tourism industry absolutely will change. So we may see some that still need to be real people. We'll see others that are replaced by automation or changed by automation for sure.
Artists, musicians.
Bingo. Yes, the creative sector is the main sector that is getting a ton of attention as really promising and one that will not be replaced by automation anytime soon. Even aside from this conversation about automation, the creative sector is one of the most promising sectors for economic development and job growth in Vermont and across the country. And we are really lucky to have the Vermont Arts Council leading the charge, a statewide creative network really here devoted to helping build that creative sector. And you and Woodstock are especially lucky to have a really strong creative sector already. By creative sector, I don't just mean artists and musicians. It's much bigger than that. It's designers, it's architects, it's people who do all kinds of creative work. It's teaching artists, people who are working with kids. It's makers, it's craftspeople. So a lot of potential there and a lot of room to grow the kind of high quality, caring community that we want to see. So I'm going to stop there. Anyone feeling scared at this point?
Yeah.
A little bit? Okay. So my intention is not totally to scare you. Everything I just told you, again, sounds a little bit scary, and there are a lot of potential negatives there, but there are a lot of potential positives as well. And the question is not, how do we deal with this doom and gloom situation? It's, how do we take what we know is likely to happen and some things that may or may not happen and use them to create the community that we want to live in? How do we take this knowledge? How do we become a more informed community so that we can shape the future that we want to have and deal with the change that is going to happen? I loved, oh, Alita. Yeah.
I just, a point to put all this in context, I think, and most everybody here, I know most of you, is just for Woodstock, we know that 52, maybe close to 55% of our village residents are seasonal homeowners. So that is a factor when we look at all of this that puts us, and we're not alone in Vermont, but certainly it puts Woodstock in a very different light.
Yeah.
So I think that when we look, you know, to 2030, which way are we going to go? Are we going to make this town affordable and open the doors, or are we going to become a retirement community?
Big, big questions.
Wow.
Yeah. Great.
So I always leave folks at this point with this quote here from Yogi Berra, which is, if you don't know where you're going, you might end up someplace else. So hopefully what I just told you gives you some clue to where we might be going. As much as it's scary, we kind of have to look. We have to know that this is coming down the pike. The second part of where we're going is up to you all, though. And that's why we're really here tonight and why we're really here to help you over the course of the next few months. Because there's a lot that you can determine and create. If you don't do it, then change is just going to happen to you. And you've probably all seen communities where that happens. My favorite local example is just up the road from you, of course, New Vistas. Is everyone familiar with that?
Yes.
Yeah, the proposed development up in Sharon, in Tunbridge, in Stratford, in Royalton, which would have brought thousands and thousands of people into compact towers in a little mini village, right? And a developer walked in and started buying up thousands and thousands of acres to move forward with the plans. Why did it happen? Because there was no vision. The four towns had not articulated and defined what they want to be and what they don't want to be. So when you don't go through that exercise and process, someone can come in and change that. Or forces beyond your control can change it. It's not always one person. It's not always a set of people. If you do go through the exercise as a community and spend the time talking about what you want to be and who you want to be and how you're going to get there, then the change is in your control. You can make change by creating great projects and working together and moving forward. And you can also define it so that developers and new residents and people coming in, folks who are in town with great ideas, can look at it and say, okay, I know what Woodstock is. I know who Woodstock is, and I can be a part of that. So I'm going to give you a couple quick examples of how communities have done this. Hopefully it leave you with a little bit of inspiration and positive thinking before we move on and talk about where we're going to go from here. So a couple examples. This is a little town called Victor, Idaho, which is just over the mountain pass from Jackson Hole. Dave and I had worked on a project out there a number of years ago. They were starting a visioning process as well and saying, what do we want to be? And started doing some storytelling, just talking about what used to be great about Victor, what they loved, what really made it a community. And one of the themes that came up over and over again is that people used to wave to each other, right? When you're driving down the car, it might be a little three-finger wave, might be on the side of the street, but that was something people used to do. And with an influx of new residents, the people who couldn't afford to live in Jackson, they were seeing that die off. Just having that conversation and identifying that thing allowed Victor to do something about it. And what they decided to do was start an annual holiday called Wave Day, where they all stand out on the side of the street and wave to each other. Did this solve all their problems? Absolutely not. But what it did was put a stake in the ground and say, this is the kind of community we are. This is important to us. We wave to each other. We introduce ourselves. We smile. We know each other. And that's what we're going to be going forward. At the other end of the spectrum, looking at economic development. So one of the most important things about communities is that the successful ones grow and change really incrementally. They don't plop down thousands of houses in the middle of nowhere and expect that thing to succeed and work. It changes over time. Think about the buildings and how Woodstock has grown. If you were to look at aerial photos or Main Street photos from the 1800s, and zoom up until now, you would see a little building here, a new story added on here, a little bits of growth. And that's really important because that allows people to experiment and take risks and make changes. One of the challenges we face as communities today is expecting people to go full force, jump in with 2 feet, and take really big risks. So I know one of the challenges I've heard about is some empty storefronts on your Main Street, or small business owners who might like to have a business here but can't quite afford to do it. Pretty pricey to have to buy a whole storefront or rent a whole storefront on your own. So here's an example out of Pennsylvania. This has actually been done all over the country. But another way this community said, we value our small entrepreneurs. We want to be a community where people can start a business and take a risk, and they don't have to fork over thousands of dollars for a big storefront. And what they did was set up a little village of sheds, basically, where business owners could just say, I'm going to take 1 month and try out my business and see if I can make a go of it. And it might only cost them $100 or a couple $100 in rent. This has been done in urban areas in empty lots, where again, the real estate may be totally out of reach for people who are starting up. But what's surprising is how many of them actually succeed and then go on and they grow their business. They sign up for a second month and a third month and they get bigger and bigger. And before too long, they are renting the storefronts on Main Street. So another example of how real incremental experimental growth can work. Here's one out of Detroit. Everyone knows Detroit's story at this point. Detroit decided it had a vision for the future, and it was about comeback. It was about community members getting together and solving their own problems, small little projects that would start to revitalize neighborhoods. They just needed a little funding, and they needed some connection. So they started Detroit Soup. It's a monthly dinner. They make a giant pot of soup and bake some bread. Everyone who walks in the door donates $5 if they can, nothing if they can't. Several community projects that want to get off the ground stand up and they make a pitch for 5 minutes and tell everybody what they want to do. And then everyone there votes on which one they want to see happen, and they get the money from the door. So every month, this community walks away funding one essential community project. And at the same time, they have a great dinner and get to know each other and chat. Here's one just from across the border in New Hampshire called Sustainer Raisers. Here's another community, not unlike Woodstock. Wolfboro realized we have older adults, we have vulnerable adults who need help. They need services. They need their homes to be more resilient and floodproof. We have young kids who need to be trained for different kinds of jobs. Some of the jobs they expect are going away. But green core service jobs like installing solar panels, installing rain gardens are growing. So they put those things together and said, let's create a program where we're training our high school students to go out and do these installations, build rain gardens, build community gardens, install rain barrels, and do it for free or very low cost for the older or low-income adults who need it, and pay those kids at the same time. So they're creating youth job opportunities, youth training, and getting the work done that needs to be done. Another New Hampshire project, New Hampshire Listens. Fascinating. So this is now all over New Hampshire, but it's community dialogue. A lot of communities recognizing that if we're going to solve all these challenges we have together, it has to be through dialogue. We have to be able to actually talk to each other and listen to each other and work through the hard issues. And so they train corps of facilitators who are able to have those conversations and help residents have those conversations on the tough community issues. One of my favorite ones, I'll leave you with a funny one before a couple local examples. So most communities we work in these days have speed issues, and they understand that it's not just about grumbling about fast cars in the road. This is about accessibility. It's about making it safe for people to walk and bike where they need to go and for families to live. So when that's clear in a community, you can do a lot of things about it. You can pay for really expensive traffic control. You can install lights. You can install speed bumps. But when that vision is clear to everyone in the community, people are actually empowered to take matters into their own hands as well, like this woman here. So one of my favorite examples of do-it-yourself community action, this is incredibly effective. Stand out on your lawn with a hairdryer and turn it up a car's going past. And I promise you they will slow down. A couple local examples you may have heard of. Chelsea was really struggling, has been struggling for a lot of years just up the road, and they finally just got everyone together for potluck dinner and said, what are we going to do about it? And they picked art. They said, we're going to have an arts collective, and we're going to have art walks, and we're going to have open mic nights and barn quilts, and they have done it. And there is so much energy and momentum in Chelsea and so much funding coming in the door for Chelsea right now that it's unbelievable. It's about making a choice as a community about who we're going to be. Manchester, Vermont did a similar project a few years ago. They said, you know, we're going to be a community where our youth are involved, where they know how government works, where they have a say in the future and feel invested. And what they did was create two seats on every single town board and commission for high school students. Voting members on everyone that was not legally prohibited to be. So, and the students that participated in this program came away saying, actually, I know how government works. I know how to make a change. And I think I want to move back here after college. Here's my town, Bethel, right? Many of you know Bethel has not had the greatest success over the years, got to a point where it was pretty run down. We did not have anywhere near the resources and community support, government support that you have here in Woodstock. But we knew that we had to do something about our downtown, which was filled with empty storefronts. Traffic moved so fast. There was nothing to do. Nothing would draw you there. Looked run down. And so what did we do? A project called Better Block. We said, let's transform the whole thing. We'll give it an extreme town makeover in a weekend, all with volunteers. And we did it. And what's come out of that has been incredible. We had people stand there and say, wow, I can actually feel what this would be like if we made these changes. We have had probably about a dozen buildings and businesses either turn over, be sold, new businesses form, buildings that are painted and under renovation, which is absolutely incredible. Art projects coming up, new committees forming, so many groups working together. So I'm going to ask you to pull out those trigger fingers one more time and then let you hear about some community projects. So if you could travel to 2030 Woodstock at this point, what would you most want to see? Would you want to see full storefronts, historic buildings, working farms, diverse people, housing for all, engaged volunteers, or something else? That's a very good point, but I'm asking which one most. We're interested in priorities here, so if you had to pick one. So polling is open. No swaying the audience. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So it looks like housing is a really big priority. Having diverse people in the community is a really big priority. Number 3 would be working farms. A would be full storefronts. So, full disclosure, this is obviously not a complete list. This could have been 20 items long. This is just an interesting snapshot. I'm curious, the 3% of you who said other, just toss out, what do you have in mind?
Like, I think it's specifically like more interesting businesses. Like, it's kind of variation on A,
yep.
But not, I feel like right now that there's a very like monotheme business culture downtown, and you know, things that were more interesting endeavors from a business perspective.
Cool. Anyone else have an other? Okay. Co-ops, interesting, awesome.
All kinds of co-ops, not just food co-ops.
Yeah, great. So you've all been listening to me for a while, and we're going to stop and let you listen to some other people. So much is already happening in Woodstock to move toward these goals that we just talked about. I'm especially interested to see what you picked and then know who's coming up. For speakers, you're in for a treat here. When we came on board, one of the big priorities we heard again was to help people be informed about what's already happening in the community, to know what's going on, what the status is with a lot of projects underway. And believe me, there's so much underway here compared to other places we work. So we've asked a handful of folks in the community, just a handful, to get up and do what are called lightning talks. They each get only 3 minutes to tell you what is going on with a really cool community project here. So quite a challenge. You've got to cheer them on and make sure they know you're behind them. Claire is going to be right here. So speakers, she will be flashing you a card when you have a minute left or time. In the interest of time, I'm actually going to ask all of our speakers to come and just kind of hang out toward the front so that we can transition right from one to the other. And for the rest of you, I want to encourage you to hold your questions for them. Undoubtedly, you will have a lot, because when we adjourn in here in a few minutes after they're done, we'll have a little more time to mill around outside and encourage you all to go talk to them and find out more about what they're doing and ask all the questions that you have. Okay? So with that, you know what? I'm going to actually skip forward and get to them first. Okay. So, what's happening? Our first speaker is going to be David Simmons. And all the speakers, if you want to come up over here, please do. Okay, come on up.
So, hi all, and we are so delighted that you're here at Billings Farm and Museum. And I've been asked to talk about a project. Well, actually, I'm going to talk about 50 years of projects of the Woodstock Foundation and give you a little primer on that organization. And I've only got 3 minutes, so it's really tight here. So, for more than a half century, the Woodstock Foundation has provided leadership support toward enhancing the cultural, recreational, economic, and aesthetic dimensions of this special town that we call home. In 1968, Lawrence S. and Mary F. Rockefeller established a private foundation, the Woodstock Foundation, with a mission to promote conservation, sustainable land use, and heritage as values that are essential to culture, community, and the human spirit. This succinct yet powerful statement has guided the work of the foundation over the decades, from the undergrounding of the overhead utility cables in the town center, to renovating the town hall, protecting vistas and open space, to offering grants to local nonprofits, and more. One of the most significant projects undertaken in 1983 was the development of the farm across from Mary's ancestral home into the Billings Farm and Museum. 15 years later, in 1998, the Marsh Billings Rockefeller National Historical Park, which had been privately gifted by the Rockefellers to the people of the United States, became Vermont's only national park. Coterminous with the establishment of the park, our near neighbor, was the creation within the Woodstock Foundation of a fund that supports ongoing preservation and forest management. In 2004, the Woodstock Foundation became a public charity. Beginning in 2007, the former local grant-making function of the Woodstock Foundation was transferred to the Vermont Community Foundation. Through the Lawrence and Mary Rockefeller Fund, the advisory committee at the Vermont Community Foundation continues to fund local Woodstock area grant applications. The next year, in 2008, the Woodstock Inn and Resort was gifted to the Woodstock Foundation, the sole shareholder of the subsidiary, which is privately managed by the Woodstock Resort Corporation. All told, the Woodstock Foundation is deeply enmeshed in three community anchors that add vibrancy, economic benefit, and enjoyment. From a four-star hotel and its amazing array of such amenities as the spa, Kellyway Gardens, Athletic Club, and Suicide Six, to a national park with America's oldest managed forest, to a still-working 150-year-old farm and now a museum bounded by a river and mountain and sitting on the edge of an extraordinary village. Again, we're delighted that you're joining us here at the farm, where, as the largest project of the foundation, we continue to improve our campus, new parking lots, which you've all seen evolve over the last year, learning kitchen, bathrooms, renovated activity barn, new heifer barn, and we provide innovative visitor programming and engagement. And with our partners, we produce delicious cheese and now other dairy products from our award-winning Jersey herd. So there we have it.
Award for stopping at exactly
3 minutes. I wish I had real awards to give out tonight. Thank you, David. Next, we're going to hear from Alita Wilson at Pentangle Arts.
Welcome. Okay, I've got to start my clock. Most of you know I'm Alita Wilson, Executive Director of Pentangle Arts. I've been in the position for 5 years. I am a Woodstock native. I grew up at the Blue Horse Inn, 3 Church Street, which funnily enough is next to the Town Hall Theater, where I had my first kiss and other surgery things. So I'm full circle. I'm just going to talk a little bit about some of the challenges we face at the town hall, our future as an organization founded in 1974 when I was 13, and the town hall theater are inextricably linked. The future of that building, the bones of which were built in 1900, had a renovation after a fire in 27 and another renovation in 1988. So we as an organization are living with some pretty old stuff. When we assumed the stewardship of the theater and the adjacent spaces, we assumed the movie operation in 1988, completing the second renovation in the building's history. Pentangle is a rent-paying tenant in the building, responsible for the cleaning of the basement first floor areas, excluding offices upstairs. We are responsible for the maintenance of all the theater's sound, lighting, rigging equipment. Technical upgrades since 88 included the purchase of the digital projector, thankfully by the town in 2014, and the audio system for live performances. The sound system for the projector goes back to the 90s. Upgrades to lighting, rigging, drapes have been piecemeal since 88, leaving much of the technical equipment outdated, in some cases obsolete. The interior of the theater, which you all probably know, the dressing rooms, access to the stage are not ADA compliant. The seats were upholstered in 88, but the bones of the seats were installed in 1940. Wow. Cognizant of the tattered condition of the carpet, seating, drapes, and ADA noncompliance, we applied and received an EDC grant, for we are very thankful, with which we were able to launch a feasibility study to test the waters for a capital campaign. It yielded largely positive feedback and support for the organization and the vision, but lacked the lead gifts for the to launch the campaign. Stepping back, it may have been in our interest, since we know now that there is structural work needed with the building, which would have probably impacted our ability to do a full renovation. Going forward, we have received a $50,000 matching grant from the Byrne Foundation to address the critical upgrades to our sound and lighting system, without which we could not present live performances or rent the venue, a vital income stream, without expensive rental packages. Further, we would not be able to continue running our movie operation. So we are at a crisis point technologically, and we hope that with the strong support of the community and community foundations that we will match the Byrne Foundation and at least be able to keep the operation going and attract the revenue stream we need to keep the organization going. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thanks, Lolita. Next, we have Jason Jerbico talking about the high school.
Okay, so this is totally unprepared because I just found out as I walked through the door that I was going to proxy Garrett Smale, who's the high school principal.
You can do it.
I can do it. Okay, so I'm Jason Jerbico. I have been a resident here for 16 years, three small children. I volunteer, as many of you know, in schools. I'm a telecommuter, came here as a telecommuter. I'm involved with a private foundation locally. So the schools, as many of you know, good schools, excellent schools are linchpins of healthy communities. We know that. I hope you know that. And we are facing a number of challenges at the school. And I'll start with challenges first. These are not unique challenges. They're challenges that Rebecca talked about across the state. One is enrollment, kind of stagnant or declining enrollment. One is metrics. Our metrics are not very good in terms of kids going to college in terms of math proficiency, English language proficiency. That's kind of universal across the state. We're trying to address. We're dealing with a facility that is a 1950s era facility that is two decades overdue. It's the architect just called it functionally obsolescent, which is a very kind way to say it's kaput. ADA, fire, air quality, you name it. So it's an infrastructure problem. So those are the challenges. The opportunities are great. We live in one of the most desirable communities in New England. We have an incredible site at the school. The assets we have as a community are in high demand. And we actually attract lots of tuition students within our district. For those of you you don't know, the Woodstock District, the Woodstock Union, Supervisory Union, is six communities, six towns. Reading, Bridgewater, Killington, Woodstock, Pomfret, and Plymouth, and Barnard. Is that right?
Seven,
okay. There's a lot going on at the state level, but the major challenge is high fixed costs, limited number of students, and a revenue problem. Our strategy, or the strategy to address this, is to become a destination district. We put a stake in the ground and say we're going to be number one, two, or three in the state and be a destination regionally. We need bodies. It's very exciting. We've had a new superintendent, Mary Beth Banyos, and I encourage you to speak with her. We need your help in flipping the switch here. She's just launched a strategic plan and completed a strategic plan. She's launched something called Profile of a Graduate, Portrait of a Graduate, rather, which outlines the skills necessary for our kids, our children, to be competitive in a global economy. And we've just completed a master plan for the middle school, high school, which looks at, you probably saw on the front page of the Standard, different levels of options of investment to address the issue. One of the major challenges we face is education finance, and this is material to our entire conversation. I just ran some numbers on Monday. So within our district, we raise about $43 million in education tax revenue. Okay, $43 million for education tax revenue from those seven communities. It costs us $18 million to educate our students. So the $25 million is exported because of Act 60. That's a fact. It's a constraint. It's a constraint for reinvestment in our community that affects the town hall. It affects the percentage we give to the senior center. It affects the percentage to the library. It affects our capacity to reinvest in a new school. It affects our capacity to reinvest in filling the potholes and the sidewalks. So that is something that this visioning process must address, has to address. So that you just have to put that out there, because we need to be able to reinvest in the community to do any of these things. And that's something that we're going to have a community conversation about how to address that. But there are exciting things happening in the school system. And I encourage you all to speak to Garen Smale and Mary Beth Banyos, because we need you, and we're going to become a destination, and that's going to add to the vitality of the community.
How about a few extra cheers for Jason for doing that on the spot with no warning whatsoever? Great work. John Spector is up next to talk about the EDC. Advance or give me a nod.
Okay, do I advance like that? Okay. The EDC's objective is to promote economic growth in Woodstock. Since 2015, we funded about 40 projects. This is most of them. This is through about 6 months ago. We spent about $500,000 raised from the options tax. You can see some examples under quality of life. We funded the flower baskets, the part of the village lighting. Around the green, we funded the Optimus Center, which is which is surprisingly important. I think when the Secretary of Economic Development came here from Vermont, the first question she asked was, "Do you have a work sharing space?" We funded expansion in childcare, early childcare support with the Rainbow School and WCCC, which was important. We put a lot of money into marketing and to the website. The website volume is up 80% this year. Over last year, huge growth as a result. And we funded a number of studies under planning, including 100% the full cost of this study. And if you look across this list, if you look across this list, I think you can draw two conclusions. First is that every one of these projects has passionate Woodstock residents behind it trying to make the town better. And I think in most cases, they've succeeded in making the town better. I mentioned the impact that we've had. We've seen tourism growth. Revenues in tourism are up 7-8% per year since the EDC was reformulated in 2015, and that's higher than the state's average. So that's the first conclusion. I think some good things have happened. I think the second conclusion, though, is that we haven't yet had the impact that everyone wants to have, which is immediately more people living in town full time, more kids in the schools, more younger people being attracted to live here. That's not something that happens overnight, so I don't think it was possible to achieve that. Maybe our expectations were too high. But the EDC, I think, as a group, I think I speak for the most people on the commission, saying that we recognize that that while these projects and programs have been valuable and they have been supported by the community, we haven't yet had the impact. We need to do some bigger things. And so we held a special meeting a couple of weeks ago and identified, and this says draft because we haven't finalized this yet, But we identified five priorities. Marketing Woodstock, which we'll continue to do. Expanding housing and related services like childcare. Third is improving physical amenities, things like the revitalization project, the river trail up Teagle's Landing, which we've just funded for that a couple weeks ago. Supporting businesses and the business environment. We have a program for storefront incentives. I think we can do more working with the merchants in town and setting up policies that maybe make it easier to do business. And continuing to support community initiatives through the community grant program. This is a work in progress. I think going forward, the commission is committed to larger projects in these priority areas and more of a focus in these areas than perhaps in others. And I guess I would encourage you, and there's a few other members of the commission here tonight, I would encourage all of you to come, if you'd like, to our next meeting is June 6th, where I think this discussion on priorities will continue and will be finalized, and then we'll present it to the select board. Thank you.
Amazing work from the EDC. Great. Beth Finlayson to talk about the Chamber of Commerce.
I'm really not talking about the Chamber of Commerce. I'm talking about revitalization of the village. But my name's Beth Finlayson. I'm the director, executive director of the Woodstock Area Chamber of Commerce. And I have to say that I think I have had the two best jobs in Woodstock ever. I was the director of the Council on Aging when it started in 1978 until 1993. And now I've been the director of the chamber for a long time. But I want to talk about revitalization because thanks to the EDC, we have a committee that hired Dubois and King in March of 2018. And they were an architectural environmental planning firm, and they interviewed members of the community. They had public hearings, and they assessed our assets in Woodstock from Tribute Park to St. James Church. And with everyone's input, they came back with a very well-formed, comprehensive plan for the downtown. And that includes, in some form, benches, Teagle Landing, trash receptacles, bump outs, the lane leading to the Welcome Center, the green, other uses for Tribute Park, a new face on the dummy, which is the island between Central and Elm, and wayfinding signs. And that's just a little bit of this 68-page study. And the Revitalization Committee chose three easy, quote-unquote, ideas from this plan. And one is to put benches around town to make it more welcoming to people. If you've been to the green, there's some kind of rickety green ones there. And unfortunately, now that Bentley's isn't here, their benches are gone. So there's no place in right downtown to sit. So with thanks to funding from the EDC, we have 14 benches that are sustainable teak that are on order. The second is bump outs. And bump outs are a traffic calming method for crosswalks. And we also received tentative funding from the EDC, and we're still working on the logistics of the bump outs, because these are 30 by 24 flower pots full of dirt, and that will sit along the sides of your crosswalks at both North Park and South Park Street, between Gillingham's and the Flannel Shop, between Bentley's and the pharmacy, and at the bottom of High Street. So we're working on that. These will only be temporary. They will be gone at the end of October. And finally, we're working with Mary Lee Camp and Jack Rossi to create a more beautiful park in our treasure, which is Teagle Landing. It's a gorgeous place. It's kind of been forgotten, and we, thanks to the EDC and the village trustees, have a start of money to do some work there. And the first things are granite steps that'll go in because the railroad ties are leaving. And the next thing, which is very controversial for folks, are trash receptacles. So if you have ideas and you'd like to talk about them, you can really, you should look at what we have. Really take a good look at them. And I'm available, Ray Bourgeois, Joe DiNatale, Jack Rossi. We'd be happy to talk with you about your ideas going forward for further beautification. So thank you.
Great. Thank you, Beth. Perfect. We're going to finish up tonight with Deanna Jones talking about housing options.
Thank you. So first I have to say I have currently the other best job that Beth mentioned as the executive director of the Thompson. And for those of you that don't know, it is a thriving senior center, community center for older adults of all ages. We have we're so honored to be considered one of a model senior center in Vermont and all of New England, and Thomas would say the best. But we've grown each year for the last 4 years by about 250 participants, and we're serving over 1,500 seniors in the area. So those demographics that Rebecca shared earlier, we continue to work on thoughtful growth, and one of the projects that I'm going to talk about with housing is an example of that. So I have the job of summarizing some of the housing initiatives. So last year, the EDC hired a consultant to study Woodstock's housing environment. There's a 200-page report. It includes a summary of extensive data collection and analysis of housing supply and demand factors in Woodstock and the surrounding area. The report includes comments from over 400 surveys. More than 50 people attended a public hearing in February to begin the conversation about how we can better match our housing supply to meet the necessary demand. The report is available on the EDC webpage of the Town of Woodstock website. The EDC will continue to prioritize this as an effort, as you heard. So that's the basis for the next three things I'll tell you about. There are currently three housing-related initiatives that are happening. The Woodstock Community Trust, and Anna is on the Community Trust here, is creating shared equity homes with assistance from Twin Pines Housing. The goal of the program is to make home ownership in Woodstock affordable for vital members of the community workforce, such as teachers, public safety personnel, and small business owners and their employees. The trust will purchase residential property located in Woodstock, make any necessary repairs, and sell the homes to qualified households. There's currently offering a village home for sale for qualifying moderate income buyers. Additionally, there is a short-term rental task force that has been meeting to look at the impact of short-term rentals on our community. They are reviewing regulations and will report to the Woodstock Planning Commission. And third, and finally, the initiative that the Thompson Senior Center is working on. Using the proven model developed by Home Share Now, the Thompson Senior Center is spearheading Woodstock Home Share along with community partners and volunteers, and will implement a shared housing system that matches homeowners in the community with community members seeking housing. The matching process will emphasize mutual safety and compatibility of the homeowner and home sharer. Woodstock Home Share will address two key issues affecting the community: affordable housing and the large number of community residents living alone in houses that may be difficult for them to afford and maintain, or who may desire some assistance or companionship in their home. Based on the home share model nationally, we'll create a program to match those with a home with those that are seeking a housing situation. While the home sharing is open to adults of any age, historically home share programs of this nature have appealed to a somewhat older demographic, and therefore the Thompson Senior Center is well positioned to implement such a program. Using existing housing stock, home sharing addresses both the issues of affordable housing for non-homeowners and the ability of homeowners to maintain their ability to stay in their homes. Additionally, the home sharing program can be expected to address issues of social isolation and continuing independence among an aging population.
Thank you.
Thank you all so much. I'm really blown away by how much is happening in Woodstock already. If we had all night, I would ask all of you to stand up and share the other projects that you know are happening in Woodstock, but we don't, and I know a lot of folks would like to get out of here. I promise we'll wrap up very quickly tonight. What I do want to ask, though, is that you do share them with us. So some of you did already. We have some cards out in the lobby and a board where they're tucked up for you to write up just a quick blurb about what projects you're working on or know about in the community, what's happening, how people connect with you or can connect with you and get involved. We're going to make that a pretty central goal of this project, to really harvest that information, try to share that information so people know what's going on. Many of you have probably already discovered that there's a new project website up, ourwoodstockvt.org, so we'll be putting them all up there and gathering more. So on your way out the door, if you do know about more projects, please leave it there. And with that, I want to just close out the evening with a couple last questions for you, and then a snapshot of what we are going to be doing over the next few months, and a request for how you can get involved. So here's what's coming up next. Over the next few months, we have a lot of work cut out for us. Between now and about July, we're going to be entering a really exciting phase where we're taking this conversation, the conversations we're starting tonight, out into the community. And when I say out to the community, I really mean it. So I told you at the beginning, we don't often operate like typical consultants. The typical planning mode would be, let's have a planning meeting and we'll warn it in the paper, and if people care enough, they'll show up, right? We know that doesn't work. So a big hallmark of this process is going to be going to people where they are, where they're comfortable, and having the conversations on their terms. We're going to need your help with that. Here's another way we're different than a lot of consultants. A lot of consultants come in and they do that work for communities. They're the ones behind the table. They're the ones knocking on doors and having conversations. I told you already, we heard right off the bat that one of the biggest things Woodstock needs and one of the best things that could happen for this town is for the community members here to listen to each other and talk to each other. So what you get out of this process will be what you put into it. If folks in the community step up and they're out there having those conversations and getting behind the table and talking to people and gathering feedback, you will all be stronger for it. We certainly have time. Our main role can be as coaches and to help gather and analyze and crunch all that data and help you through the process. But if we're the ones having the conversation and we leave at the end, you don't get the benefit of those relationships and data. So in the next couple months, I'll give you some examples of how you can help, but want to ask all of you to think about having these conversations with your neighbors, with your families, with your staff and organizations. Around July, we will start taking all the information we've gotten back and clustering it and grouping it and analyzing it and figuring out what the themes are. To give you a comparison, we did a process up in Richmond a couple years ago, which is comparable size to Woodstock, I would say, a little bigger, and had, you know, easily over 1,000 comments come in on surveys. And our job is to take all of those thousands of comments and condense them down into one clear statement of what this community's shared vision is going forward, and then create a path for how to make that vision happen. So from about July to August, we'll be working with the steering committee and other volunteers to do that work, to take all those comments and put them into a vision that will resonate with the Woodstock community and that will help you shape that future and steer the change that we talked about earlier. And then I think we move into one of the most exciting parts. So we don't stop with a vision. We don't stop with a plan that sits on the shelf. We start asking what other projects need to happen and how do we connect the projects that are happening now and how do we build more enthusiasm and attract more volunteers and help the many, many groups in Woodstock work together more efficiently and more collaboratively. We don't know exactly what that structure will look like yet. We don't know how that will happen, but we do know that in the fall, we'll bring folks back together and be asking those questions again. Out of all the ideas that came up for how to make this vision real, which ones are priorities? Which ones should happen now? Who's already doing them? And how can we work together as a community to make that happen? So expect that from the fall on, there will be some sort of new structure. Maybe it will be working groups, maybe it will be some other community system that we come up with and create together to help Woodstock take action and work together. So a couple last questions for you. You've heard a lot about topics tonight, and I want to ask you another poll. This is another list that could be 20 items long, but out of the short set of options I'm giving you, I want to ask you which of these you think need really deep, thoughtful community dialogue. We're going to be gathering a lot of feedback, surveys, quick ways of answering questions and offering feedback, but which ones really need conversation with a full range of Woodstock residents? So, polling is open. One answer. I'm not saying we'll only do one, but just give us your top priority. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, and 1. Big range. Looks like our top two are inclusion and diversity and resilience and sustainability. So, interesting. Woo. Round of applause. Now, I want to pause for a second and note that, of course, we told you we're all really excited that you're all here. You are all welcome, and of course, anyone in Woodstock was welcome. But in this room, and in fact, in every room where we have a community event, there are uninvited guests. And those uninvited guests are elephants. They somehow show up in every room. You've actually heard about a couple of them. We've had a couple brave people call out those topics that aren't often talked about but need to be talked about here in Woodstock tonight. Alita told us we have to talk about the fact that 52% of Woodstock residents are second homeowners. We have to talk about that and whether that's what we want this community to be or whether we want it to change. Jason told us that we have to talk about school funding and the fact that more than half of the tax funding raised in these communities is going out of town and causing some significant issues. Beth told us that we have to talk about trash cans, right? So we want to take just a quick moment and ask you to name these elephants for us. Claire's gonna pass out some cards with elephants on them, and we wanna ask you to scribble down before you leave the room tonight. What has to be talked about in Woodstock in order to really move forward in this community? It might be controversial things, it might be the things that people are afraid to name, it might be the things that we're afraid to say. This is anonymous. Do not put your name on it. You can turn it over and pass it back down the aisle. It is not secretive, so we will hang these up and we'll call them out into the open and talk about them as a community. But we need to take a minute and do this. Think about the things that people gripe about. What are people going to be saying in the parking lot later that we really should just get out right now? We want to name it today so that we have a chance to address it in public. I'm going to let you write as I carry on here for a minute and just tell you really quickly a little bit more about this process. So I told you in spring, actually, we've been spending a lot of time as a steering committee, laying the groundwork, getting rolling. Summer, we're going to start doing a lot of activities to really engage people and have these conversations, and fall and winter is about action. Here's a snapshot of what some of those activities are. So we'll have more public events like this. We have a really fun one in the works for end of summer when we have a draft vision and ideas ready to share with the community. There used to be a great community picnic in Woodstock, and we thought, what better way to share a new vision for the future than to bring back something that was really treasured in the past? So we're talking about having a community picnic again and a chance to really look at that draft vision and say, did we get it right? Is this the right fit? And now, what's already going well? Where do we want to go from here? As I said, we can't expect people to come to us. So another option on the table is called meeting in a box. And this is where I start looking at all of you. We will prepare a simple kit that has a lot of conversation prompts and questions that we need answered from a huge diversity of people in Woodstock. And we're asking for volunteers to take one of these kits and go have a conversation. It could be around your dinner table, it could be at a block party, it could be at a staff meeting. It could be that you organize something with your knitting group or with your softball team. But have the conversation, tell us what you heard, report it back to us, and we'll incorporate all those results. We'll have volunteers out at community events with tables and a lot of the postcards and things that you've seen already. I want to ask all of you to take a stack of these when you leave tonight. Hand them out. Give them to your friends and neighbors. There are a lot of ways that you can send them back in as well. And these are really two of the main questions that we're asking in a lot of different ways. What is it that you love about Woodstock that we want to be part of our future in 2030? And what do you wish? What do you wish is different, or what do you wish we can add? You can take a photo of your answers to these and share it with us on social media, tag it, hashtag OurWoodstockVT. You can text your answers in. There's a text phone number on the bottom here, and we'll be putting up posters with that as well. You can hand them in. We have a project website that is up, as I mentioned. If you go there tomorrow, you will find a survey. So we ask all of you to take that. It goes into a little bit more depth on the kinds of questions we're asking, and we want to get a couple thousand responses to this survey. We'll also have a few paper copies at strategic locations, like Town Hall, like the library, to hand out. We hope to have some other opportunities as well. So you notice the last box on here is a big other. How would you like to have this conversation? How could you help us? Do you want to organize a storytelling event? Do you want to put up a chalkboard wall? Is there some way that you can help us do this? And so we're looking for folks to play very different roles here as well. If you came and you're excited and you want to help make this a really rewarding process for Woodstock, we're looking for volunteers to help take a table out to an event where you're going and collect postcards for us. If you're interested in joining the steering committee and being more involved at a leadership level, we welcome that as well. If you're interested in helping to facilitate these conversations, if you can take one of those meeting in a box kits, or if you could come to a community event and might be interested in sitting at a table and facilitating a conversation, we're asking you to sign up as an ambassador. We'll actually train folks to do that facilitation. So if facilitation is something that would help you in your job or in your work or in your community projects, here's your opportunity to get some free training as well. We're looking for partners, which is really the business or organizational side to that. If you represent a committee or a group or a team or a club or a business, we're asking you to sign on and endorse this and say you will be a part of it. You can spread the word via your mailing lists. You can send emails out. We'll give you text and information to make that easy. You can take these, again, we'll give you a box to sit on a counter, and you can have folks at your shop or your business place just hand in postcards. If you have a restaurant, we'll be printing up some drink coasters, so you can hand out coasters and let people weigh in after they've had a couple. We'll get some good responses. And again, what else? How else would you like to be involved? This is your process to create here tonight. So on your way out the door, I want to ask you to think about this a little bit. Do take some of these postcards for real and hand them out to folks and weigh in. If you have more answers, you can do that at home. On the table by the door, there will be a sign-up sheet. So if you're saying, maybe I could be a volunteer, or maybe I could be a business partner and have a box on my counter, please sign your name and email. You are not signing your life away. You can back out. But this will let us contact you and give you more information and figure out how you might like to be involved. So very last questions for the evening here before we adjourn. I'm sorry? Oh, that took them from me. Did you all, how many of you still have them? Most people have them? Okay, then you know what? That's okay. We're gonna do this the old fashioned way because sometimes that's what it takes. So don't worry if you turned it in. We're gonna do a quick voice vote. Vote with your voice by enthusiasm here. So our Woodstock will be a success. You're only gonna give a holler for your favorite one here, the one that you think is most important for this process. How many think it's listening to each other? How many think it's ending up with a clear shared vision? Prioritizing actions that come out. Increasing collaboration. Building engagement in the community. Having fun. Something else. Yeah? What's the yeah? What else? All right, nothing else. I'm not going to make you vote on this one right now. I do want to ask you to just sign up on the way out the door since we don't have keypads, but I want to ask you to think about how you would like to be involved. Spread the word, talk it up for us. You are now all our ambassadors, in fact, to go out and tell the community that this is happening and that we need to hear from everyone. We won't end up with a shared vision and collaboration and partnerships if we don't have every voice involved. So please help us make sure that happens. Two closing thoughts for you as we walk out the door. There's one elephant I heard as soon as I walked into Woodstock and started this process, and it's that everything's going to be controversial. There won't be any actions we can take that won't cause problems or people won't get upset about. And I thought about that for a minute and said, oh dear, this is going to be a problem. So I want to challenge you to set that aside a little bit. If you are one of those folks who might get upset about something, I kind of have a feeling they're not in this room, but if you are, think about not getting upset and just letting people try some things and color outside the lines a little bit. If you're one of those people who thinks it has to be all planned out and figured out before we try anything, try setting that aside and just being a little bit open to experimentation and perhaps even to failure. What would be so bad if we tried something and it didn't actually go the way we thought it would? We might actually learn something from it. So I actually call this approach improv community. It is really aligned with improv comedy, for any of you who like that. And if anyone knows the number one rule of improv comedy, it's yes and. So that when you engage with someone, when you walk on a stage with some crazy person doing improv and they have flying monkeys around, you say yes, you acknowledge that this is the reality we're working in and that this is this person's reality. And then you say and, you build onto it, you add your own thoughts, you connect it to something else and involve. So I hope coming out of this process that Woodstock will be an improv community, that will be a stronger community, a more connected community, and I know it will be a community that is more informed and has a great sense of where it's going in the future. And we look forward to doing this with all of you. So thank you for being here. Have a great evening.